comfortable solitude for our 2022 commencement celebration. At this time, I would ask Cadet Colonel Angelo Brazzini to come forward to lead the national anthem. As Angelo finishes with the national anthem, please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance and the invocation.
Perseverance, understanding, and flexibility. Parents, today I could stand here and be 100% confident in saying that your sons are just as prepared for college and life as they would have been if there was no pandemic. I can say this because of you, the parents, our teachers, and the personal perseverance of your sons. Members of the Board of Trustees, thank you for your unwavering support for the administration and teachers during the past 5 years. Working together on a number of major initiatives to include mission expansion, capital campaign, and the building of this wonderful stadium, we have increased our enrollment by nearly 20%. Members of the graduating class, your high school years were quite unique and something that you will always remember. However, this morning, I want to focus on your success and accomplishments. As a class, you received 386 offers of admissions to 141 different colleges and universities in 28 different states and the District of Columbia. Members of this class will be attending schools such as Cornell, University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, University of Notre Dame, Boston College, University of South Carolina, the Citadel, Norwich, Northwestern, and New York University, and many other fine institutions. You also have 18 classmates who will be playing college-level sports, to include four at Division I level. This graduating class has earned $12.8 million in four-year scholarships, and the students will be studying in the fields such as engineering, film, biology, construction management, finance, and religious studies. One student plans on being a priest, and another is going to become, hopefully, a major league umpire. Most of us know that since 1850, thousands of young men have walked the halls and sat in the classrooms of LaSalle Institute on 4th Street and on Williams Road. There have been nearly 170 graduating classes. However, none as unique as this. Members of this class are part of a generation that understands what it's like to learn the hybrid environment while wearing face masks, maintaining social distances, not being able to socialize or hang out with friends, compete in athletic events, and participate in other activities. I believe that these things have made you stronger and you learned how to overcome challenges. However, to me, the most unique and historic thing about this class is that after 172 years, you are the last all-male class to graduate from the LaSalle Institute. In September of this year, we started a new chapter in our history by welcoming young ladies to LaSalle. Some may say that with this graduating class, we are closing a previous chapter on our school, and that may be true in some regard. However, no one can say that we will not continue to cherish the heritage, culture, and our expectations. On the contrary, we will continue, as we always have, to be true to our standards, values, and traditions with a continued commitment to excellence. The story of LaSalle Institute started with a few Christian brothers who came to Troy in 1850 and established our school. Since that time, hundreds of brothers have ensured that what was started and improved through the decades. Well, here we are, 172 years later, and better than ever. So on this historic day, I want to thank all the Christian brothers that have served LaSalle Institute by thanking Brother Carl Malacalza, former teacher and principal. And by thanking him, I'm hopefully thanking everyone that preceded him. We also have a couple of members of the board who are brothers, and I want to thank them also. There are many reasons why I am proud of this class. The most important is the way you supported and accepted our mission expansion initiative from an all-male school to a co-educational school. Now, I know that some of you had some concerns, but overall, you stepped up as senior leaders, and you ensured that our female students and their families were welcome, and you helped them quickly learn what LaSalle is all about and about our culture. If I was to come into the school for the first time and not know much about it, I would think that girls have always been a part of our school. Their success this first year is greatly attributed to your leadership, your pride in our school, and a commitment to be the best that you can be. You are truly young men of character. This year, my LaSalle class will celebrate our 50th reunion. Yes, you are right. It is 50 years since I graduated from LaSalle. But please know, I am very proud to have you as our alumni. I hope that the next 50 years bring such happiness that I have in the past 50 years. Gentlemen, it has been my pleasure to watch you develop into outstanding young men, men of character and confidence who have earned every blessing that you have received, and with those blessings, you helped make LaSalle Institute a better place. As you depart this wonderful school, remember to cherish each and every moment of your life. Stay in touch with your friends, classmates, and teachers. Stay true to your values and principles, and remember to come back and visit. On behalf of our administration, faculty, and staff, I congratulate you on your accomplishments, encourage you to work to your fullest potential, and I hope and pray that you enjoy your future to the fullest. Thank you for being part of LaSalle. It has been my pleasure to know you, and I thank you for being a part of my life. Congratulations.
It is now my honor to recognize the special award recipients for the LaSalle Institute Class of 2022. All of the following award winners were also recognized at our Baccalaureate Mass last night. Award recipients, when your name is called to be acknowledged, please stand at your chair and remain standing until all names are read. The Valedictory Award, Anthony Michael Bruno. The Salutatory Award, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Excellence in Religion, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Outstanding Achievement in Religion, Katachu Tesfai Hayes. Excellence in English, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Outstanding Achievement in English, Caleb F. Ells. Excellence in History, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Outstanding Achievement in English, Caleb F. Ells. Excellence in Mathematics, Xiaojin Zhou Gu, in absentia. Outstanding Achievement in Mathematics, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Excellence in Science, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. Outstanding Achievement in Science, Xiaojin Zhou Gu, in absentia. Excellence in Foreign Languages, Nicholas Gerald Rotundi. Outstanding Achievement in Foreign Languages, Anthony Michael Bruno. Excellence in Business, Tom Zhang. Outstanding Achievement in Business, Ryan Kenneth Lefevre. Excellence in Performing Arts, Wyatt Bonesteel Hartman. Outstanding Achievement in Performing Arts, Nicholas Gerald Rotundi. Excellence in Fine Arts, Nian Chen Miao in Absentia. Outstanding Achievement in Fine Arts, Anthony Michael Bruno. The Commander of the Cadet Brigade JRTC Award, Cadet Colonel Angelo Francis Verzese. The Superior Army JRTC Cadet Leadership Award, Cadet Lieutenant Colonel Aiden T. McPhillips. The Outstanding Army JRTC Cadet Leadership Award, Cadet Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Michael Bruno. The Brother James L. Roman Service Award, Nicholas Gerald Rotundi. The Brother Bryce Patrick Memorial Award, Ryan Anthony Ciancio. The Outstanding Leadership to the Student Senate Award, Krishan J. Badre. And the International Program Graduate Award, Tom Zhang. Congratulations to all of our honors winners for the class of 2022. You may be seated. It is now my distinct privilege to welcome our salutatorian, Ryan Anthony Ciancio.
Good morning, and a full-hearted thank you to Colonel Skowski, Mr. Scambori, Mr. Michelle, Mr. Brennan, Mr. Farrow, Board of Trustee members, faculty, family, friends, and all of my classmates. I am honored to stand before you today and profoundly grateful for the many people who have helped me on my LaSallean journey. My story at LaSalle begins with a quote written on a plaque, which is visible to all coming into our building. It reads, "Be it known to all who enter here that Christ is the reason for this school. The unseen but ever-present teacher in its classes, the model of its faculty, and the inspiration of its students." I don't remember the first time I read it, but its significance has grown in me over my 4 years walking these hallways. This educational philosophy was championed by the namesake of our community, St. John Baptist de La Salle. You don't need to know his history to appreciate his legacy. In fact, much can be learned by the way we start every class. Beginning in prayer, we say, "Let us recall that we are in the holy presence of God." De La Salle built his ministry on this consistent reminder, so that his actions would be defined in service, faith, and love. We have prayed this prayer multiple times every single day, but have you ever thought about what it really means to be in God's holy presence. Take a moment to imagine Jesus standing by your side. With Christ in the seat next to us, our standards will undoubtedly rise, and so will our successes, and even the love we experience. We recall his holy presence to focus our priorities so that we can walk with God and allow him to work through us. As I reflect on our time together, I recognize that the stories of our class are all interconnected, as Christ is our foundation. You don't have to wait for a miracle to feel God's presence. It has been revealed to me in the warmth of our classmates and the caring of our teachers. In my journey, Ms. Corlew has changed the way I see the world. Mr. D has ignited a spiritual passion within me. And a day hasn't gone by that Coach Washington didn't make me smile or laugh. To my friends, which number the cadets gathered here today, you are the reason my experience has been so fun and memorable. God's presence is manifested in our unique identities, passions, and personal gifts. It is seen in the classroom, on the athletic fields, in service to others, in artistic expression, on the drill floor, carrying the colors, in spiritual celebration, and in our brotherhood of support for one another. Soon to be graduates, it is now our time to move forward and step into the next phase of our lives. Along the way, we are certain to find challenge and hardship interwoven with success and triumph. We are prepared for it all. Keep God's presence in your heart, live that truth in your actions, and you will find fulfillment. We have called upon St. John Baptist de La Salle every day in prayer. Please hear his wisdom in embracing Christ in others and allowing God to be your light, strength, and compass. To the class of 2022, congratulations. I am blessed to know each and every one of you, and I thank you for your company over the past 4 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan, for those beautiful, inspiring, and very important words. It's my honor to introduce Mrs. Roberta Grieco, math teacher and moderator of the National Honor Society, to acknowledge members of the class of 2022 who have earned induction into the Brother Arnold chapter of the National Honor Society.
Good morning. Members, when I call your name, please stand and remain standing until all the names are called. Ryan Anthony Ciancio, President. Anthony Michael Bruno, Vice President. Nicholas Gerald Rotondi, Secretary. Caleb F. Ells, Historian. Krishan J. Badri. Cole Davis Bourgeois. Morgan Jeffrey Dyer. Dominic Kwame Breffo, Jr. Stephen Patrick Higgins. Raymond Edward Hutton. Chen Hua, Stephen Kang. Christopher Ryan Keneally. Jeffrey Thomas Madelon. Ryan T. McCarroll. Aiden T. McPhillips. Mian Chen Miao in absentia. Evan Murray. Aiden John O'Brien. Christian Eric Reynes. Alexander Michael Ryan. Dylan J. Slicko. James Ransford Whalen. Edward John Yaman IV. Tom Zhang. Congratulations to the members of the Brother Arnold Chapter of the National Honor Society.
It is now my esteemed privilege to welcome our valedictorian of the class of 2022, Anthony Michael Bruno.
Welcome, members of the administration, treasured teachers, beloved parents, families, and my LaSallian brothers. I am honored to stand before you today as we celebrate our achievements. As I look out at my fellow cadets, I am reminded of a promise Mr. Maloney had to repeat in the early years of my education here at Sal. Some of you may recall it, join me if you do. You are a cadet. You are a cadet who models truth, honor, and duty. You are a cadet who takes responsibility for his actions, words, and deeds. You are a cadet who cares for and respects his family, peers, and teachers. You are a cadet who gains strength through success and learns from failure. You are a cadet who does the right thing even when no one's looking. You are a cadet who seeks to excel on the classroom, in the field, and in the community. You are a cadet now and will be for life. This promise is the basis of our LaSallian education. More than words, it is a compass guiding us, charting our course as we navigated the treacherous high school waters. Moving forwards, I see this promise as one which will guide our future. If we continue to model these core values of truth, honor, and duty, each of us will enjoy a lifetime of success. I recently finished reading The Boys in the Boat. This book is a true account of the nine-man American crew team during the 1936 Olympics in Berlin. This remarkable band of rowing brothers had awe-inspiring determination through insurmountable odds. The main character, in explaining the crew's ability to achieve the pinnacle of success, spoke of the importance of the shared experiences of rowing with his friends, bound together forever by pride, respect, and love. I cannot help but see similarities between the boys in the boat and my fellow cadets. The core values of truth, honor, and duty are woven throughout the book, much the same way as they have been instilled in us throughout our years at LaSalle. In rowing, there is a moment of near-perfect synchronicity called swing. Swing is achieved when every single member of the group overcomes their bodily limits through laser-focused attention and becomes one with the team. Swing symbolizes the unity and bond of brotherhood. Swing is described as an ideal state of harmony, one which can only be achieved when all rowers trust and respect each other. In much the same way, we at LaSalle have attained our own remarkable state of swing through our shared experiences and core values of truth, honor, and duty. Our brotherhood, like the crew, stays on course because of these core values. First, I'd like to talk about truth. The boys in the boat all held truth close to their hearts. The author states, "What mattered more than how hard a man rowed was how well everything he did in the boat harmonized with what the other fellows were doing. A man couldn't harmonize with his crewmates unless he opened his heart to them. He had to truly care about his crew. The team was able to achieve greatness once they realized that their trust in each other was the key. At LaSalle, truth is never giving up on our personal and collective journeys. We cadets worked collaboratively in the classroom and on the field, staying true to our individual and common goals. By opening our hearts and offering support to each other through our time at LaSalle, we became better athletes, artists, musicians, and scholars. We achieved our own version of swing, born from our commitment to truth. Through truth comes honor and duty. Honor. Being honorable means working hard and being held accountable. To achieve championship caliber, a crew must have total confidence in each other, confidence that no man will get the full weight of the pole. As a result, the members have complete trust in each other, working together seamlessly. Good crews are a good blend of personalities, someone to lead the charge, someone to hold something in reserve, someone to pick a fight, someone to make peace, someone to think things through, and someone to charge ahead without thinking. Like a good crew, LaSallians are men of honor and integrity. Honor is our most treasured possession. We demonstrate honor by making difficult decisions and not fleeing from challenges, even when no one is around to witness it. Striving to do the right thing at all times. LaSallians have total confidence that each of us will pull our own weight. We know that when faced with adversity, we can count on our fellow cadets. Duty. In the book, the crew has exercised their flexibility, their ability to yield, to bend, to give way, and accommodate in order to honor their commitment to each other and their shared dream. This sense of duty, at whatever personal cost, became a source of strength for the crew. Over the past 4 years, we have faced challenges individually and as a group. We endured an unprecedented global pandemic, quarantines, remote learning, isolation, and mass classes. We endured losses on the field, academic difficulties, and personal challenges. Through all of these difficulties, we fulfilled our duty by improvising, adapting, and overcoming the hurdles in our path. By doing so, we cadets enjoyed many successes, including conference championships, section titles, academic excellence, and national recognition. Whether these exploits were a part of a team or individually, together we achieved accomplishments that were once only dreams. We are like the boys in the boat, a band of brothers, bound together forever by our core values of truth, honor, and duty. We are cadets now and will be for life. Thank you, good luck, and God bless.
Weren't those two speeches some of the most magnificent words that you've ever heard? At this time, I am pleased and very proud to introduce our commencement speaker to you this morning. pleased because he continues to support our school, and proud because he's a member of the class of 1979. When we talk about LaSalle graduates, we often talk about well-rounded individuals. We talk about them being men of integrity, and talk about them about being builders and responsible for their actions. Well, Mr. John Thero is an excellent example of what we want our graduates to aspire to. While at LaSalle, he excelled in academics, athletics, and service. He was a member of the National Honor Society, earned gold honors each of the 4 years, and he was a leader in the Student Senate. He played 3 sports, football, basketball, and baseball. I understand that of the 3 sports, he was most successful in football, as his team was ranked highly in the Capital Region at that time. After LaSalle, John went on to College of Holy Cross in Massachusetts, where he earned a business degree with concentration in economics, accounting, and computer science. During his long and very successful career, John helped start and resuscitate 7 different companies, majority of them focused on improving healthcare. Before retiring last year, John was president and CEO of Ameron Corporation, an Ireland-based pharmaceutical company characterized by leading physicians as pioneering the most significant breakthrough in preventive cardiovascular care in the past 3 decades. Under his leadership, the company grew from about 12 to over 1,000 employees and is credited with improving the health of hundreds of thousands of people. While some drug companies are thought to have overly priced products, third-party watchdogs groups deem his company produce highly cost-effective with the potential to save money for society by reducing high costs associated with strokes, heart attacks, and other severe cardiovascular events. In 2019, Mr. Thero was named by Ernst & Young as Entrepreneur of the Year for Life Science. In 2018, in an investor survey conducted by Stats, he was voted as one of the top 3 biopharma CEOs in the world. Actually, he was number 2. John currently resides in Florida. He is a board member of multiple public companies and speaks periodically on various business topics, including ethics, focus, growth, and accountability. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our guest speaker, Mr. John Thero.
Thank you, Lieutenant Colonel. Good morning, everyone. Isn't he great? You know, I hope, absolutely. You know, I hope you all appreciate how fortunate LaSalle is to have, you know, Joe as the head of LaSalle. Under his leadership, with support of his team, LaSalle has not only weathered numerous hardships, including COVID, but become stronger and better positioned to teach young adults, male and female, for years to come. I find his commitment to LaSalle and its students to be highly inspirational. Congratulations to the soon-to-be graduates of LaSalle's class of 2022. You made it. My comments will be directed to you as aspiring young adults. My aim is to provide some advice while challenging you to make the most of yourselves. Given the very thoughtful comments of the student speakers before me, some of this advice may not be needed, but I hope you assign some value in it nonetheless. First, I ask all of the soon-to-be graduates to please stand up, that's you in the uniforms, take a step forward, turn toward your parents and salute them. Now remain standing. You can bring down your salute, snap it off. You can turn face me, that's good. Yeah, history shows that young adults with supportive families tend to be the most successful and happy. You are fortunate. Clearly your families want great things for you or they would not have sent you to LaSalle. If you're anything like me, you may today think that you have most of the answers. Such confidence is good. Confidence found in graduates often reminds me of self-deprecating, somewhat humorous comments from Mark Twain along the lines of the following. When I was a teenager, my father was so ignorant. But when I got into my 20s, I was astonished by how much he had learned. Your parents know a lot, and I am certain that their life experiences will benefit you in uncountable ways in the future. Next, please look in front of you at LaSalle's faculty. These dedicated men and women also believe in you. Hopefully, you found them to be demanding. You're undoubtedly better as a result. You and they overcame challenges of learning and teaching in the COVID era. Their teachings have prepared you well for the future. I ask you to respectfully salute your teachers and then sit down. In life and throughout college, I found that my LaSalle education prepared me well. The often heavy LaSalle homework burden taught me to effectively manage my time. And like you, at LaSalle, I was exposed to students from multiple cities and towns with various backgrounds. This experience expanded my horizons beyond the town in which I lived. I hope that as you move forward with your lives, you resist the temptations to hang around slowly with people like you. Learning to effectively interact with people is one of the most important things you can learn in life. College and the workplace can be great melting pots for this portion of your education. Ironically, those of you who are going to large colleges, despite often having more diverse student populations, will have it harder to make this happen, as like people tend to surround themselves with like people. In each of the companies that I've formed or helped fix over the years, we had a code of conduct. Mr. Bruno referred to this well. In developing such codes, I often referred to truth, honor, and duty. In the corporate world, we use terms like integrity, quality, and teamwork, but the spirit was the same. Whether you refer to truth, honor, or integrity, please be mindful that these are virtues that only you control, and if lost, they are very difficult to recapture. I have often heard your graduation referred to as commencement. Indeed, graduation marks a new beginning for you in the next chapter as young adults. It is time for you to take more responsibility, think and plan more, and overall become more self-dependent. You have earned this step forward. It is up to you to make the most of this opportunity. In my comments, you'll hear me advocate that you use this milestone in your lives to rapidly become self-dependent. These concepts apply whether you're going to college or not. Because the vast majority of you have elected to go to college, most of my comments are directed to you. My comments reflect my own experiences, as well as those of my three children, and observations from many others. I could give advice on how to have fun at college. I won't. I'm confident you'll figure that on your own. Instead, I intend to provide commentary regarding a sort of topics which I indeed hope you find constructive. The list of colleges you're attending is impressive. Also impressive is the massive level of scholarships many of you earned. Again, congratulations. I hope you appreciate that going to college is not a predefined destiny. It is a major life choice. I hope you elected to go to college because you, as young adults, believe that this is the best path for you. I'm not trying to second guess your decision or change your minds. I want to encourage you to make the most of the opportunity provided by college. Not everyone does. In my many companies, we often hired people with college degrees into jobs that they could have done with a high school education. Sadly, they didn't apply themselves in college, and 4 years later, they amassed a lot of debt without increasing the value of what they had to offer. I asked some of them why they went to college. Typical responses included their friends were doing it, their parents wanted to, wasn't ready for work yet. I trust you've given this important choice in your life a lot more thought and that you intend to take it more seriously. College can be wonderful. How much you get out of it is up to you. Few people enter college knowing exactly what they want to do with their lives. At a minimum, you should enter college intending to challenge yourselves. One of the most important things you can do is to learn to better interact with people from varied backgrounds. Make an effort to become friends with people who are different from you, including international students. Try coursework, which is outside your comfort zone. In topics that you're studying, don't limit your learnings to the materials assigned to you by professors. There's so much more to learn beyond the minimum requirements. As an aside, whether you're going to college or not, I believe that everyone should learn the basics of economics or accounting. Glad to hear that there's some people who did very well in business here at LaSalle. Companies large and small that fail often do so because people managing those enterprises, despite being very good at their crafts, didn't adequately understand the operating and financial aspects of their businesses. You may be a good carpenter or a good architect or a good doctor, but if you don't understand economics and accounting, you're placing yourself at a disadvantage to others and unlikely to maximize your opportunities. Begin now with your education, with your commencement, to better understand what you like and don't like. Determine your strengths and interests, and then plan what you want to do and pursue it. Certainly ask others for advice, but do so as a thinking person. Always consider the source of the advice you receive and filter it accordingly. You are now too old and too educated to blindly rely on the advice of others. I've often heard college students tell me that they pursued degrees in noble areas such as sociology or oceanography because they liked them or because their college professors advised them to follow their passion. For some students, this will turn out fine. For many others, beware. Idealism without pragmatism may seem pure and noble, but when pursued in a vacuum, it can lead to frustration. For example, I've heard oceanography majors cite the accomplishments of Jacques Cousteau, the renowned marine conservationist, as justification for pursuing passions in their field. It is true that there are cases of passion leading to success. However, be wary of examples with small sample sizes. Too often such pursuits leave college needing to go to graduate schools or to change their field of study and starting over. Some of these former students, now graduates, expressed that they wish someone had provided them with a better dose of reality from the start. So I echo those their comments and experience in my words today. I'm not trying to be negative. Rather, I am encouraging you to use what you have learned in high school and determine what is best for you for the long term. In doing so, don't overlook that college professors need to fill their classes to keep their jobs, such that, intentionally or not, they may be somewhat biased in what they recommend for your class choices and majors. The decisions you make will have lasting impact on your futures. Betting on idealism alone or on fate or serendipity is typically not as reliable as thoughtfully planning and executing, and of course, making adjustments along the way. On the positive side, the United States is the greatest meritocracy in the world. If you work hard and work smart, you will advance. At times, sometimes might not seem fair. For example, people sometimes seem to advance faster because they're fast talkers or have connections, rather than having ability or making contributions. In the end, in my experience, people who work hard and smart will advance. Don't fall behind in your studies. The course loads tend to be compounding, and many classes have exams and papers due at the same time. Expect days when you get little sleep, and don't be too proud to ask for help from your family, professors, tutors, priests, or others. Paraphrasing the jazz legend Louis Armstrong, you and your generation will learn much more than I will ever know. However, you will learn it much faster if you ask questions along the way. Don't be ashamed to admit that you don't have all the answers, and learn from the failure of others so you don't repeat their mistakes. Also, when you get to college, expect that the first test of each semester will be particularly difficult. Professors will want to make sure that you realize that they have high expectations. I recall being shocked on one of my first tests when my score was a 38. I was accustomed to better grades at LaSalle. I later learned that 38 was the second highest score a student earned on that test. Nonetheless, it motivated me to work harder and eventually got an A in the class. Be ready to be challenged and seize that challenge. Today, the United States is at near full employment. This means there are good jobs available for people who want them. It doesn't mean that you should expect to stop at the top, start at the top. Unless you're working in a family business, you likely know very little about what you're going to do. Be realistic. Expect that not all work will be fun. But wherever you elect to work, if you work hard and take on more than is required, and maintain a positive attitude, your skills will expand, you will stand out, and progress. Hopefully, the strong economic growth experienced in the United States over the last handful of years will continue. However, history suggests that prolonged periods of economic expansion are typically followed by recessions. There are early signs that a recession may be coming, which signs could be worsened by growing international tensions. As you plan for your future, think about what you might want to pursue in your dreams in economic times, both good and bad. When I graduated college, it was a recession. As you likely know, recessions are periods where the economy slows down and getting a job can be quite difficult. After my first year in college, I increased my focus in two areas which I thought were recession-proof. One was the emerging field of computer science, the other was accounting. I elected to go into accounting, not because I love accounting, but because it allowed me an opportunity to look inside many businesses. This worked for me. Other people I knew weathered the recession by working in healthcare or for utilities. Everyone's different. I'm not trying to suggest what's right for you. I am trying to encourage you to plan. Understanding what's best for you will take time. For me, I learned that business, which I initially thought would be glamorous, weren't right for me. I learned that I preferred smaller companies over larger companies, and I preferred to be involved with companies finding solutions to complex problems. Later, I learned that if I was going to work that hard, I prefer to be working in healthcare and improving people's lives. None of this was recognized by me when I entered in college, but self-reflection and some recession-proof planning helped. The baby boomer generation is retiring, which brings you opportunity and challenge. By way of opportunity, the country needs to have people to fill many positions, particularly in the trades, such as plumbers, electricians, elevator repair, and truck drivers, but also professional and spiritual positions, such as nurses, doctors, teachers, and clergy. The baby boomer generation, which I'm a part, has also accumulated tremendous governmental debt and unfunded social programs, the cost of which may be difficult to support unless the economy grows. I will argue, or excuse me, many will argue, myself included, that this isn't fair to your generation. Nonetheless, it is unlikely to change anytime soon, and it may get worse before it gets better. Despite this burden, if you work hard, seize opportunities, you can get ahead of it. As you plan for your future, don't ashamed to want to be prosperous. Individuals, businesses, states, and countries which are prosperous are in position to do great good. From prosperity comes more job creation, more charitable giving, and more solutions to environmental and energy challenges. History shows that innovation which can overcome great challenges and improve living standards tends to come from prosperous societies and people. If you become prosperous, don't forget the people who helped you get there, including LaSalle, as you'll then be in a position to help them as they've helped you. A few other pieces of advice. Don't make a fool of yourself in the first week of college. After 40 years, I still remember fellow students who became overly drunk or otherwise embarrassed themselves in the first weeks of college. As you may have heard from college or from your coaches in sports, if you score, act like you've done it before. You'll have increased access to alcohol and drugs. There is no undo button in life. Think before you act, and don't leave the impression that you've never been out before by getting embarrassingly drunk. In case you don't follow the news, beware that too many students are dying from fentanyl overdoses. In the past year, there are more than 100,000 deaths in the United States alone from fentanyl. For young adults, fentanyl killed more people in the past year than COVID. Life is wonderful. Don't lose the chance to live it because of a short-sighted decision or because other people are doing it. Speaking of news, it's a wonderful source of education. However, if you're getting it from TikTok or other forms of social media, you're likely getting a limited or unbalanced version of the news. Try to get information from multiple sources, separate fact from opinion, and consider the source of potential biases from whomever is providing the news. Be careful of over-relying on headlines, as the value in a story is typically found much deeper in the text. In some of your college courses, knowledge of current events will be important. One of the best job offers I received my senior year of college was aided by discussion in a job interview of a then-recent Wall Street Journal editorial. This hadn't been planned, but the discussion led to it being relevant. As you likely know, interviews for jobs begin at the end of your senior year, begin at the start of your senior year, as do applications for graduate school. In essence, you have 3 years, not four, 3 years to get ready. The time passes really quickly. And as you may know, time is often the greatest constraint. Whether you were studying or running a business or doing more, nearly anything in life, there's rarely enough time. One of my daughters, while in college, proclaimed that sleep is for the weak. As the statement suggests, my daughter wasn't a science major. Sleep is needed. But the spirit of what she expressed worked well for her. As she got involved with numerous activities and friend groups, and she's a better and happier person as a result. Encourage freedom of expression. Regardless of whether you agree or disagree with the view of others, the increasing trend to disrupt or threaten speech is not constructive. Learning is accelerated by listening to the thoughts of others. Once you've listened, you can elect to agree or disagree, but find ways to express your opinion without acts of violence or disrespect. Exercise. You know, those of you who are going to play college sports won't have to worry about this for a while. But as life goes on, you know, whether in college or afterwards, you find that there's often not enough time in the day, and some people sacrifice exercise. I found that if you exercise for an hour a day, it gives you 2 extra hours of energy. And exercise can be a great way to meet people, whether it's intramural sports, going to the gym, joining a cycling club, softball, or whatever. Also, acknowledging that you're a class of graduating young men, make note that young women can often be easily met at the gym. Also at the library. Call home often. Your parents may be advised by your college to avoid calling you frequently so they don't make you homesick. Don't interpret their lack of communication as a reason not to call them. Call for reasons beyond learning how to do your laundry. Don't wait to graduate college before getting work experience. There's only so much you can learn in the classroom. And college will mean more to you if you are paying for it. Get a summer job. Get weekend jobs. Don't worry, unless perhaps you're pre-med or playing Division I sports, you'll have plenty of time to study even if you have a job. For most people, the added time constraints of a job will help you improve your focus and keep you out of trouble. Work experience also looks good on your resume when you graduate. And don't be too proud to take an initial job, an entry-level position. Develop some skills, you will advance. What you learn from working can be unexpected. For example, one of the jobs I had in college was for the United States Postal Service. At the time, many of the full-time employees of the Postal Service previously had been drafted in the military and served in Vietnam. They were a bit of a tight-knit group. Initially, they didn't take warmly to a part-time worker from college who hadn't been to war and wasn't part of their union. Over time, I built friendships with them, as they saw I wasn't out to make them look bad. They warmed up to me as they learned that I played rugby and worked in a bar at night. As I got older and began managing employees, I often reflected that what I learned from those interactions with those postal workers. Self-dependence is rewarding. For many of you, I suspect that your parents have been planning pay for your college for many years. Have you been planning as well? As young adults, how much are you going to let your parents pay to help you advance? I suspect that some of you, through work, loans, and our scholarships, intend to fund all or a substantial portion of your education. If you are, kudos to you. If not, I encourage you to reconsider. And of course, be prepared to be self-supporting upon graduating college. I suspect I speak for most, if not all, of the parents here when I say they don't want you to be dependent upon them after college. They want you to grow up and support yourselves. Supporting yourselves is expensive. It was a huge eye-opener for my children when I forced them to put together a cost of living estimate that included rent, utilities, insurance, transportation, food, phone, entertainment, etc. It can be great to know how much it's going to cost after college, you know, how much you need to earn. There are tools on the internet to help with this. Your parents can certainly help. A small investment of effort can be eye-opening. and consider giving back to the community. If you haven't volunteered at a food bank, consider doing so. If you're medically inclined, work at a retirement home or in a hospital, or get involved with distant runs or bike rides for charity. Volunteerism can be as rewarding to you as it is helpful to others. It also looks good on your resume. I could go on. Warm day, I won't. I won't. I hear from the Pirino Gallery back there. I want you to get to your diplomas. Yeah, there are many things that tie graduating classes of LaSalle together. One such bind is a simple but meaningful prayer which should be familiar enough to all you graduates, and I hope you participate. St. John Baptist de LaSalle, pray for us. Live Jesus in our hearts forever. Thank you. Time to get your diplomas.
Thank you, Mr. Thero, for your words today and for your continued support of our wonderful school. We have now arrived at the heart and purpose of our ceremony this morning, the awarding of diplomas. The LaSalle diploma is given in consideration of a student having completed the prescribed studies in the academic course. The diploma states that the student has attained creditable proficiency in their studies and in the art of rendering knowledge available for the purposes of life. Cadets, when your name is called, please come forward to receive your diploma from Mr. Thero. Pose for a picture. Colonel Roskowski will be there to congratulate you as well. LaSalle Institute awards diplomas to the following students.
Anthony Michael Bruno, valedictorian. Ryan Anthony Ciancio, salutatorian. Angelo Francis Bersays, cadet colonel. Krishan J. Baudry, President of the Student Senate. Daniel Eomidie Amasho. Thatcher S. Boswell Pence. Cole Davis Bourgeois. Ryan Breen. Dominic Kwame Brefo, Jr. Kevin D. Bruno, III. Anthony M. Buffaline. Damani Omarion Canty. Matthew James Carey. Christian C. Chung. Tyler Michael Colleton. Justin Joseph Cooper. Peyton Joseph Corsi. Gavin Malone Crosby. Ryan Curran. Cole Kent Duncan. Morgan Jeffrey Dyer. Alejandro C. Ebanks. Caleb F. Ells. Jack Edward Finland.
Angelo Stephen Fuda. Gianni Michael Gabriel. Jordan Antonio Gamble. Joseph Henry Gilbert. Edmund W. Gertler IV. Ethan H. Grangey. Ashton John Frederick Hartman. Wyatt Bonesteel Hartman. Wang Zhao Young. Raymond Edward Hutton. Blessing D. Jackson.
Hong Chen Hao. Eamon M. Kelly. Christopher Ryan Keneally. Jacob Nicholas Kaczynski. Nicholas Thomas Christel. Caden John Krasminski. Bryce Patrick Kuo. Nicholas Adam Lidopoulos. Brian Kenneth Lefevre. Jeffrey Thomas Madelon.
Ryan T. McCarroll. Aiden T. McPhillips. Niachin Miao. Evan Murray. Sean Garrett Nijan. Dominic M. Nemier. John Tyler Nimmons. Omari N. Norbrun. Jack Harrison Norton. Aiden John O'Brien. Dev R. Patel. Christian Eric Reynes. Aiden Radigan. Jacob Richard Riberty. Logan David Rogers. Nicholas Gerald Rotundi. Alexander Michael Ryan. Nicholas Augustus Chaldone III. Dylan J. Slicko. Daniel Patrick Sovey III. Anthony Francis Testo. Devante Avion Thompson. Nicholas Patrick Tobin. Ethan Solomon Urowski. James Ransford Whalen. Edward John Yaman IV. Andrew Yee. Louis Robert Zalucki. Tom Zhang. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the class of 2022.
Good morning, everyone. We're going to do one more round of applause in 1 second for this wonderful group. So to our parents, our family members, special guests, teachers, staff, administrators, members of the Board of Trustees here today, I'm so glad that we're all here to celebrate this exceptional group of young men who have overcome challenges, excelled academically and athletically, and have persevered through the difficulties and hurdles that the last 2 years have provided. This class is a special group. Let's give one more round of applause for the class of 2024. I also want to acknowledge again our principal for 7 years, Brother Carl Malakauza, here today. Brother Carl, thanks for being here. My comments will be brief. So when you work in education, it's a common belief that educators do the teaching and the students do the learning. But in reality, if you pay attention, it's actually the students who do a lot of the teaching. And I've been very fortunate enough to learn a lot of things from this collection of graduates. They've taught me a lot about passion and how when you're passionate about something, you can carry yourself through many obstacles. Like Krishan's passion for acting, which was on full display in last weekend's production of Beauty and the Beast. Kevin Bruno's passion for umpiring baseball games. Bryce's passion for his favorite purple sweatshirt. Blessing's passion for by far the best winter jacket in the school this year. And Eddie Gertler's passion for the Boston Celtics. Now, Eddie, I'll be honest, I didn't know how that last line was going to resonate because of Game 6 yesterday, but we lucked out, so. Passion breeds excitement, and excitement fuels growth. So, guys, never lose that passion, and thank you for teaching me how important it is. This group also taught me a lot about humbleness and sportsmanship, like Wyatt Hartman excelling on the athletic fields and then winning the Best Musician Award in the same year. Or Gitch Hayes winning race after race and setting record after record. Nick Tobin making an incredible diving catch against Burn Hills in the playoffs. Nick, I still say you completed that catch. Or one of my personal favorites and one moment that I will never forget that I shared with my 7-year-old, Ray Hutton making it all the way to the wrestling state finals. Unfortunately getting defeated, but then showing a level of sportsmanship that I've never seen before, acknowledging and congratulating his opponent in front of thousands of fans at MVP Arena. And finally, this class taught me a lot about enjoying life. Like when Peyton's eyes lit up when explaining to me how to properly fish a crankbait lure. He's taken all the blame if I catch no fish this summer. Thank you, Peyton. Eddie Yaman telling me in September or in early October, Mr. Scambolora, you need to smile a little bit more. I was driving home and I said, he is right. He was 100% right. Eddie, thank you. Or when Ethan Grangine gave me a crash course on all things related to excavation, something that he is really, really into. Ashton Hartman teaching me how to use one of his favorite words. Word. And finally, Evan Murray talking to me about the best places in the Capital Region to find a steak. So graduates, indeed, you've taught me an awful lot, and I'm appreciative of each and every one of you for your talents, gifts, skills, and most importantly, your passion, humbleness, sportsmanship, and ability to enjoy life. As I close, remember to never stop learning, take time to smell the roses, keep God close, be thankful for the small blessings you have, and of course, one of your favorite sayings from this year, and one that forces optimistic thinking, a little rain doesn't stop the plane. Congratulations, best of luck. No matter how far away you get or how close you are, a piece of LaSalle will always be with you. Thank you. And before we wrap up, I want to thank Mr. Thera for some wonderful words. We have a special gift for you today, Mr. Thera, so thank you very much. we've reached the conclusion of our ceremony. Following our alma mater, the graduates and their families will exit one row at a time from the stadium going this way. Please stand.
Thank you. stay gone. Sometimes you bend, sometimes you stand, sometimes you turn your back to the wind. There's a world outside every darkened door where blues won't haunt you.